So I am a music teacher. That's my day gig. That's what I do during the school year. So I do have a background in music. I went to college for music, Duquesne University, and I have a degree in music technology, and then I have my teaching certification also. So, you know, I've been doing music for a long time. Since I was about 14, I started taking guitar lessons and got into music that way, and then continued on with guitar throughout school, and started teaching guitar lessons after that, and never really played in any bands. That's not something that I ever really wanted to do, but I did enjoy playing, and I enjoyed music in general. And then, you know, I went back to school, got my teaching certification, and I've been teaching elementary music for a few years now. And then for the mashups, I started doing those like 3 years ago. It was something that I knew that those things existed on the internet, that people were making them, and it just intrigued me, because I thought, well, maybe I'd be able to do this, because I have an idea of how they would be put together with isolated vocal tracks, instrumental tracks, and it's really just a matter of mixing them together and, well, of course, figuring out what goes together and kind of doing that. And, you know, I started a YouTube channel and, yeah, just kind of went from there. It was definitely something on the side just for fun. I knew that I probably would never make any money, because, and YouTube doesn't pay me anything, because I'm using copyrighted material. So any of the ad revenue that's generated will go to the record companies or the recording artists, which is fine. And, you know, that's not the reason that I did it. I didn't want to try to like do a career change or anything like that. It was really just for fun. But I think it also grew out of being the type, you know, I consider myself an introvert. I consider myself a person who was not comfortable up on a stage. You know, I've done a handful of gigs in my life where, you know, I mean, and I could play relatively well. I never considered myself a fantastic guitar player by any means. But enough that I could hang and I could play a gig and I could do fine. But it was, you know, so I would play a gig, and then afterwards I thought, well, that was, you know, that was great. Like, I accomplished that. I did it. It's over with. But I didn't enjoy myself in the moment. You know, I'm not that kind of person. I don't like being in front of people. I don't like all the eyes on me. I've never really wanted to do that. The only time I ever have is because I thought, well, I'm supposed to, you know, I'm a guitar player. That's what you do. You're a musician. You perform, you gig, you do this and that. And people would ask me all the time, like, well, why aren't you in a band? Why don't you do this and that? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't want to. You know, that's not my thing. That's not something that I want to do. And that was always a frustration, because then I go and ask myself, like, well, I feel like I can do music. I feel that there's something, and that I have an understanding of it and can do this and that. But then I think, like, well, why did I do that? Why did I go into music as a profession and blah, 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 you know? But then I found this, you know, doing the mashups, I could do it. I could take as long as I want to do them. I don't owe anybody anything. Nobody's paying me anything. I can do whatever I want with these. And it's behind the scenes. You know, nobody's watching what I'm doing. No, you know, I do it until I have a finished product and I put it out there. So I can, you know, I was able to still develop an audience, but I don't have to do anything live, you know, which is, it just really appeals to me. I'm not like an in the moment live kind of a person. I just don't work that way. I'm behind the scenes. I like to do all the work and then put it there and see what happens. Now, and I wanted to do something on social media too, so that people could see it, because I mean, that's just the way to do things now. Everyone's on their computers, their phones, on Facebook, on YouTube, whatever, you know. So that's where, if I could put things on those platforms, and then people would see them, and I would have an audience, and, you know, so that's what I wanted to do. Now, before that, I would do guitar solos. I would play guitar solos, just guitar covers of songs that I liked, and I had those on just an Instagram channel. And you know, I was doing them and I was taking all these takes, and, you know, maybe after 20 takes, I could finally do it well enough. I'm like, okay, there you go. Like, that was good. I can actually post that one, you know, and get maybe 50 views or something. And, you know, it dawned on me, like, what's the point of doing these guitar solos that have already been done? They've already been done by somebody else exactly this way. So I'm not, there's nothing creative about it whatsoever. Mm-hmm. It's just a carbon copy of something that's already been done. So I lost interest with that. I didn't want to do it. But then at one point I had this idea, and this is when I was still doing guitar videos on Instagram. I had this idea to take, it was Every Rose Has Its Thorn by Poison. So to take that song, and during the solo section, instead of playing the solo from that song, I would play the solo from Knocking on Heaven's Door by Guns N' Roses. Because I knew, well, they have their same tempo, same key, so it's going to work. So I did that, and I, you know, I played, like, I wrote in the caption something like wrong guitar solo, you know, and played it. And they worked together because they were compatible. It sounded cool. So that, I guess that could even be considered my first mashup, if you will, you know, two different songs, two parts put together. And I thought that was kind of a neat concept. Cuts through the wound heals, but the scar, that scar remains. Shortly after that, there was a guy, he's still doing mashups on YouTube as well, DJ Cummerbund, and he's been doing it for a long time, but he had, you know, one that I consider one of the best of all time, which was Crazy Train and September, the Ozzy Osbourne, Earth, Wind & Fire, and yeah. That was the one that I saw that I just like, oh my God, that's incredible, like that's, and I thought about it, I'm like, well, it makes perfect sense, they're both in the key of A, and around 120, 130 beats per minute. Like, yeah, of course they would work together, you know? But of course that was, you know, I give him props for being able to find that combination because it, you know, it worked so well together and had all these views. And I had friends of mine who were sending me links to it. And I'm like, yeah, I know, I saw it. It's really cool. And then at that, I just started thinking, well, maybe I could do this. Because again, for having the music technology background and doing a little bit of with mixing in GarageBand or in Pro Tools or Ableton Live, those different pieces of software, I knew how to go about it. So it was really a matter of finding combinations. And I you know, I'm a huge fan of Steely Dan. They're if I had to name a band, you know, that is my all time favorite, that's who I would pick. So, and I had a vocal track of Do It Again by Steely Dan. I had found one of those and I knew, okay, it's in the key of G minor, around 130 beats per minute, somewhere around there. So what can I find that would go with it? And, you know, at that point, I don't think I was really searching databases. I didn't know that they existed, but I was going through stuff that I knew. And I don't know how, but somehow Motley Crue came up, and I didn't think it at first because I thought, well, this Motley Crue song's in the key of A minor because that's the way it's played on the guitar, but really it's not because they tuned down a whole step, so really it sounds in G minor. So I thought, okay, these two are actually the same key, same tempo, let's try this, let's see how it works. And then I just went about putting them together, and I really liked the result. It was really cool. And that was the very first one I did. That's the one that started my YouTube channel. The editing, I really pretty much taught myself how to do. I had GarageBand on my computer. So I just kind of messed around with that. I would put some tracks on it. And the first one that I did, you know, 3 years ago, I didn't do a very good job as far as the editing goes, because I didn't really know how to do it. You know, I was trying to do some things in other software, and you know, extract from one piece of software, put it into GarageBand, and I was losing sound quality and stuff, so I didn't really know. But just through trial and error, I kind of figured out, well, I can just rip all of these MP3 tracks off of videos from the internet, because everything that I do, pretty much, most things I find on YouTube. So I'm able to download a YouTube video and convert that to an MP3, and then with that MP3, just drop that into Logic Pro X, which is what I use on Mac now, which is similar to GarageBand, but it does a lot more. And it just became easier after a while, you know, and that's for the audio part of it. And the video, I never had any training whatsoever. You know, once the audio is done, you export that and put it into, I use iMovie to do the video part. And I just had to really figure out from scratch, well, how does this work? You know, and I kind of figured out, well, you can find music videos that you want, and you're not going to, I don't use any audio from those videos once I'm putting the video part together, if that makes sense. It's just the silent video clips with the mashup that I've already created, that audio part going along with it. And I mean, iMovie's pretty user friendly. So I was able to go in and figure out how to grab this part of a clip and put it in a timeline and just go back and forth between one song and the other, you know, this clip here. And just, you know, over the years, I thought, well, maybe I could kind of emphasize this part of the song a little bit more, like this music, this whatever, this guitar fill or something, and have a close-up of the actual guitar player playing that part. And and again, that was just trial and error and just more or less self-taught on that part of it. Ain't no mountain high, ain't no valley low, ain't no river wide enough, baby. If you need me, call me, no matter where you are, no matter how far. Don't worry, baby, just call my name, I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry, oh baby. Yes, there is a method. It's not necessarily the same every time. It depends on where I'm starting. Most times I start with the a cappella, with the isolated vocal track. And I know just from being a musician, I know what key it's in and approximately what the tempo is. And if I don't know, I can check with a tuner, or I can check with a metronome. And so let's say I know that I have this song that is, or this a cappella vocal track that is in the key of A minor, and it's 120 beats per minute, okay? So now the first thing I do once I have that is I go through and I can think, is there anything off the top of my head that I know of that's gonna go with this song? But, you know, let's say that I have my vocal track is a, like an R&B or a soul kind of a thing, you know, like James Brown, for example. And I'll try to do something that it's rock and roll on the other side of it. So the instrumental would be rock and roll or metal. Because those two, they really go well together. His vocals with that kind of raspy, really powerful sound that he has. And the one I did with James Brown was with Motorhead. And you know, the hard rock, the guitars, drums, bass, and everything from Motorhead really works well with his voice.
That makes super bad. I got soul, I'm in love, and I'm super bad.
But going back to what I was saying before, when I have a vocal track, A minor, 120 beats per minute, if I can't think of anything, where I'll go is there's a database online that I found. It's a karaoke website. So they offer instrumental tracks or karaoke tracks that you can buy. But what I use it mostly for is their search engine that they have on there. So you can enter in the key that it's in. So I would, you know, I would write in or click on A minor, and it could show me every song in their database that's in the key of A minor. And then if I wanted to limit that to around 120 beats per minute, key of A minor, then I can search from between 110 beats per minute and 130 beats per minute. So everything within that tempo range, along with the key of A minor, they'll show me all the songs that they have in their database. If I can't find anything, then maybe I'll bump it up a half step. And if I find a song that way, great. Most times I don't, so unfortunately, and I have to look elsewhere. I might go onto Apple Music, the radio, like the Apple Radio thing, and they have a ton of stations on there. And I'll literally just go through like the hard rock station and play a song. Like, no, that's not the right key. Go to the next song. No, that's too fast. Go to the next song. Next and next and next. And I have found a couple of matches that way. You know, it's kind of an off chance that I would find something, but sometimes I do, and then I can make them work that way. Then it's a matter of, you know, hopefully I can find an instrumental version of that song to go along with the a cappella that I already have. Sometimes you can't find anything. You could find like a karaoke version, which, you know, usually you can tell that it's a karaoke version of the song, meaning it's a re-recorded version, not by the original band. Sometimes you can find the actual instrumental version, which is just the original track with the vocals removed. All the original guitars, bass, drums, keyboards, whatever, are all still there. And then, you know, you can then layer the vocals on top of that. And the other part of it too, is that you can never take the two songs and leave them completely intact 100% and expect them to work together. You have to edit as far as the form of one of the sides, maybe in the instrumental. Normally you have, you know, section A, section B, section A, something like that. Well, maybe you need two section A's happening and then a section B and maybe back to section A. So, you know, you can do those kinds of things and edit them that way and still maintain the integrity of the original song, you know, if that makes sense. If you go and try to change it too much, then it's no longer going to sound like that song. So I always avoid that if I can. You know, don't change the instrumental too much. Don't change the a cappella too much. Don't start changing pitches all over the place. Don't change the rhythm any more than you have to make it fit. But you have to do that a bit. So it's a kind of a balance of, we'll change it just enough to make it so that it really works, but not too much that it no longer sounds like that song.
Propaganda, death of dumb, barbarian to be. Comes rotting through the night in bloodless misery. Comes as a policy, the reason for the sea. The pestilence, it shakes the place, they beat and blood rage. Sometimes it kind of drinks a free. Fun and sunshine, there's enough for everyone. Whoa, that's missing in the sea. But don't worry, you can
sometimes. The very first one that I did, the first like soul metal one, was Marvin Gaye and Rat. And the funny thing is because that was the one, that was the mashup I did that put me on the map. I had been making them for about 8 or 9 months before that. Cause I can remember the first one I did, it was in May of 2017. And it wasn't until February of 2018 when I did the Marvin Gaye and Rat one. So I had made something like 20 mashups before I made that. And to tell you the truth, I didn't think anything of it. I didn't think like, oh, this is spectacular. I can't wait to upload this. This is going to get a million views. Not at all. It didn't feel that way. I just thought it was another one. I thought it was good. I thought it was really cool. But not just, you know, head and shoulders above everything else that I had already done, because I liked the other ones I did too. But so I uploaded that to YouTube, and, you know, after a week it had like 500 views, which was pretty typical. Actually, that was kind of a lot at that time when I only had 50 subscribers on my channel. Yeah. If I got 500 views on a video, that was really pretty good, you know? And so I thought, okay, well, that one did okay. And then I got I was out with my friend. I was at a Y&T concert, and I had some notification from YouTube, which I never got because nobody ever commented on my videos. And it was saying like, oh, this is the coolest thing. This is going to blow up. You know, it's like, no, it won't. Like, really? Like, no, that hasn't happened before. But then a little later, I did a Google search on it and found that there was an article that was written about it, you know, from an online publication through Facebook. I thought, oh, that's awesome. Like, somebody wrote an article on this. That's really weird. And then I checked the views, and at that point it had close to 10,000 views. I'm thinking, what? Like, you're kidding me. Like, 10,000 views on this already. And that was around like the next morning, it was 10,000 views. And then by the end of the day, it was over 100,000 views. And I thought, well, this is incredible. Like, because this is, I mean, that's why I started making them. Of course, I love making them and I love the combinations, but I wanted to develop an audience. I wanted people to listen to them and to like them and to think, well, this is really cool that these things go together and enjoy what I do. So that's kind of how that started. Within a week, it was over maybe 500,000 views. And then I was checking the views on my older videos that I had done, and those were starting to get more views because people wanted to see other things that I had done. But, and I'm sure for that first video, some the Marvin Gaye and Rat, that somebody had called it soul metal at that point, and then it just kind of stuck. Trying to think what I did after that. I think that the next video was, it wasn't a soul metal one, but maybe a few videos later I did a one with the Temptations, and it was Temptations and Aerosmith. And that one works just naturally really, really well together. I had to change some things in the instrumental part to fit the form, excuse me, of the vocals. But, it wasn't enough to really matter very much. And it, you know, both were in the key of C minor, and they worked really well together. And, you know, I thought, well, this is a cool thing, this whole soul metal, and I wanted to see how many I could do.
I can turn the gray sky blue. I can make it rain whenever I want it to.
When it comes down to it, style really doesn't matter at all. There's musical elements that transcend any style or any genre, because any genre you're in, you're going to be dealing with rhythms, you're going to be dealing with key, you're going to be dealing with melodic patterns and those kinds of things, chord progressions, and the style really doesn't matter. It's, you know, if you have something that's in the key of E minor, you have these seven notes that are in that key, you could find another, so it's like a rock and roll song in E minor. Well, maybe I could find an R&B song that's also in E minor. So they're going to be compatible that way. And the hardest part is finding a vocal and an instrumental that will match in terms of phrase lengths. So you'll have a vocal part where they're singing, you know, starting right on the downbeat, and the phrase lasts for four beats, or maybe it lasts for eight beats. Then the instrumental has to also allow for that, and they have to be able to fit that way. And that's another thing, that style, it really doesn't matter. You can find those phrase lengths in any kind of musical style. So it's finding those things that the transcend genre, that once you find compatibility that way, again, the genre really doesn't matter. But of course, I find it boring to find, you know, and a lot of people will say to me, well, there's these two songs, you know, they're both classic rock songs. They're both in the same key. They both have the same chord progression. You should do this mashup. And I'm thinking, why? They're basically the same song to begin with, you know, and why make a mashup with two songs that are already pretty much the same thing? And because it wouldn't sound like anything new, you know, you wouldn't have really created anything. So that's why I like that the different genre stuff, that when you first listen to it, sounds like, well, no way would these two go together. It's impossible. You can't do it, you know. And that's where I like, okay, yes, it can, because of A, B, and C. This is how this will work together. And that's when I find that I've created something new. You know, it's not, I mean, I say new, it's not technically new, but it, because it's using recordings that already exist, but it feels new because it's two things that you already know together make it sound really different. Wake up, grab a brush and put a little makeup. I just got the fade away, the shake up. Why'd you leave the keys up on the table? Here you go, create another fable. Grab a brush and put a little makeup. I just got the fade away, the shake up. Why'd you leave the keys up on the table? Here you go, create another fable. You wanted to grab a brush and put a little makeup. You wanted to. I just got the fade away, the shake up. You wanted to.
My self-righteous suicide, I cry when angels deserve to die.
It's time to stop. It's time to stop, okay? No more. Where the f*** are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services. It's time to stop.
Yeah, I think the situation sucks, you know? I mean, there's different sides of it. Some artists, some record companies, they don't want their music to be messed with. And there's certain ones, you know, the Eagles, Don Henley is one of the most well-known of people, bands who don't want their stuff messed with. They don't want even a small portion of their songs in anybody's video.
Jesus, man, could you change the channel?
Fuck you, man. If you don't like my fucking music, get your own fucking cab.
I had a really
rough... I'll pull up to the side and kick your ass out.
Man, come on. I had a rough night, and I hate the fucking Eagles, man.
Black Sabbath, sometimes I've heard that you know, it depends on the record company who owns certain songs within the band. And there's so much, and I can't even begin to understand how it all works. But I've had a few videos blocked, which is not that big of a deal because you don't get any kind of a penalty for it. You don't get a copyright strike. To have a video blocked is different than a copyright strike or a video takedown. So there've been, I don't know how many videos I've had blocked. A lot of times it's just blocked in certain parts of the world. In some cases it's blocked worldwide, but sometimes it's, you know, just in Canada or just in wherever, you know, which still sucks to have blocked anywhere. But I think it does suck because I'm not making anything anyway. It's not like I'm trying to say, okay, I'm taking your music, I'm claiming it as mine. You know, I want to be paid for it. No, I'm not trying to do that whatsoever. I'm trying to do something creative, have a different spin on a song that's decades old, that you've only heard this one way. throughout all these years, and let's try to hear it another way. And that's it. It's just a creative thing, and that's all that I want to do with it. So it does suck when they get blocked or taken down. The other one that I had taken down was the first Slayer and Wham song that I did a couple years ago. That was actually just a couple months after the Marvin Gaye and Rat one. It was two summers ago. And I did. I remember I was on vacation. It was with my family, with my wife and kids, and parents were at the beach house, and it was rainy, and I'm trying to put some mashup together. And I don't know how I came upon Slayer and Wham, but you know, and that one got a lot of views really quickly. It was up over 600,000 views in a week. You know, people were going crazy. They thought it was hilarious, and it did. There was something about it. It worked so well together. And I do remember originally I was trying to find a soul vocal to go over the instrumental of Seasons in the Abyss by Slayer. I thought that would sound amazing. I'm still trying to do that to this day. I'm still trying to find something that'll work with that instrumental, because I really do like it. But I kind of gave up on that. And I said, well, I also have the vocal for Seasons in the Abyss. Let's see what instrumental I can find. And that was actually one where I did use that search engine on the karaoke site. You know, I was looking, because it's a D sharp minor for the Slayer tune. And so I'm looking either, you know, D sharp minor or D minor or E minor, somewhere in there. And then I found one that was half the tempo of the Slayer, because the Slayer one's up about, you know, 150, somewhere around there. And so I found one that was around 75 beats per minute, key of D minor, and that happened to be Careless Whisper by Wham. So like, okay, well, they're in the same key. The tempos are, you know, multiples of each other, I guess. You know, this tempo is half of that one. So let's see how that works. And then I put it together, and sure enough, like, okay, this actually sounds pretty good. You know, it actually works musically, and it's hilarious, because I can't think of anything much more opposite than those two, you know. This 80s new wave thing, and the saxophone solo and some hardcore Slayer song going together. But they went together really well. Getting back to your question, that one, once I had the mashup, it was up for about 10 days and it was taken down. That was the first copyright strike I ever had. And I had the notification from YouTube, takedown notice, copyright strike, all this stuff. And at first you don't know which song it was. You have to like go down through the email and see what it was. I'm thinking, oh no, not that new one I just did, because I liked that one so much and everyone liked it. And sure enough, it was that. They took it down. But I had also put that on Facebook, not with a YouTube link, but I actually embedded the video in Facebook so people could play it that way. And as far as I know, that's still on Facebook. And that had over a million views pretty quickly. But there was also another YouTube channel who they downloaded the YouTube video, the Wham and Slayer one, and just put it on their own channel. They gave me credit for it. They said it was by Bill McClintock. And it's still on their channels. And I think it's got like 500,000 views on their channel or something, you know. So it still exists out there, which is fine. You know, people knew that I did it, so that's fine.
Here we go. Yeah. This is gonna be cool. This dude is definitely cool. These are the coolest dudes I've ever met. Hey, slow down. Wait a minute. Squeal! squeal, and you squeal! Okay.
We have a winner.
Ah, boy. I feel pretty good right about now.
Nothing for sure. I do get approached by certain people. I don't know who they are. But they claim to have connections with big celebrities and, you know, have plans of what to do with the stuff that I do. And, you know, never anything official. Like, you know, they want to do this. They want to know more about what I do. And sometimes it's, you know, don't tell anybody about this, but this is what I want to do. This is the kind of project, and I can get all these people involved and everything. And I say, that's great. You know, let me know what I can do. But I just kind of take it all with a grain of salt because things change. And, you know, it would be nice to see if you know, there were more people who were interested in doing projects. And if it could ever turn into anything big, you know, and anything lucrative, it would be incredible. You know, as I said, it was never my intention to make money doing this, but if it's possible, if there's people who know more about the business end of it, who, you know, would be interested in using the mashups that I've made and, you know, making some money with it, then I think that would be awesome.
People moving out, people moving in, why? Because of the color of the skin. Run, 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 but you sure can't hide. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, both for me and I'll set to free. Rap on, brother, rap on. The only person talking about love and love is the preacher. And it seems nobody's interested in learning but the teacher. Segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, aggravation, and humiliation, obligation to my nation.
I'm the future. Oh, yeah.
That's what the world is today.
Oh, yeah.
The cell appeals are at an all time high. You're both walking now with their heads in the sky. City's aflame in the summertime.
Oh. The beat goes on.
Now listen. Appalachian revolution, gun control to sound so. Shooting rockets to the moon, kids going up to Zoom. Politicians say more taxes will solve everything.
And the band played on.